Hello and good afternoon everybody. I hope you all are fit and fine at your homes. So take care of yourself and don't go out. Now, today we are going to continue with Maths 2, Standard 9, Basic Concepts in Geometry. Previous we had done how to find the distances between two points on the number line. So we'll continue that. We had done till practice set 1.2. Now see, if you see over here, practice set 1.2, we had got till question number 4. Now see the question number 5 over here. If you see over here, the number line is given and few questions are given over here. So the first one is write the opposite ray of ray RP. Now see here, this is RP. So here opposite ray, if the ray is starting from here, the opposite will be on the in the opposite direction. So here you will get a ray RS or ray RP. So first one is ray RS or ray RP. That is the opposite ray of ray RP. Next, the intersection set of ray PQ and RP. Now this is PQ and this is RP. So this ray it will intersect over here. So here it will come ray PQ. Now union set of ray PQ and QR. So PQ and QR. So here the union set will be the line PQ or the line QR. That will be the union set for ray PQ and ray QR. Now next, if you see rays of which segment QR is a subset. Now if you see QR, QR, it is a subset means it should pass a form of something. So here you will get ray RQ, ray SQ and TQ. So here you will get see RQ, SQ and TQ. It is inside of that. That is one. And the set itself is a subset of its own self. Now opposite rays with common endpoint R. Now common endpoint R, opposite rays. So here it will come RP, RS, it can come RQ, RP. Two pairs it can come. Now here two rays with common endpoint as S. SR and here ST. Now as you all know, ray, it will originate from one point and it will go on. So here it is ending. Now next, intersection ray of SP and ST. So here SP and ST, intersection point will be the point S which is coming in both. So this is the fifth question of exercise 1.2. Now we'll see further. Now if you see the sixth one, it is same as the previous exercise what we have done. Means looking at that you can find out how to find the distance. Now see here, if you see question number 6, state the points which are equidistant from point B. Now if you see the point B, you will find A and C are equidistant. Now I draw that line over here, you will not be able to understand. So if in between you are getting as that is A, this is B, this is C, this is B, and here you have B as 6. After that you have your point A, then you have P which is minus 2, then you have L, then it is Q, that is minus 4, it is Q. Then you have U and then you have R, that is minus 6. Now see here, state the points which are equidistant from point B. Now if you see here, which are the points which are equidistant from point B? So here you will find A and C. So points A and C are equidistant from point, and both are at the unit of 2 units. See here. Here also 2 and here also 2. Next is what? Next what you will get? See here. From B, if you see A and C, they are at an equal distance. Correct? Now again, if you see more here, this, and from B you will find this. Here it is having distance of 4 units. So for 4 units, it will be P and D. So P and D are at an equal distance from B, which is at a distance of 4 units. And here A and C, they are at a distance of 2 units from B. So here for C and A are equidistant from point B, and you will have D and point P. Now write a pair of points equidistant from Q. Now see, Q, you will find U and L, which is 1 unit distance. Then you will find R and T also, which is at a distance of 2 units. So here, I hope you have understood to find the distance. You have to find the points which are at the same distance. Like for B, it was A, which is only 2 units from to the left hand side and also 2 units to the right hand side. So A and C are equidistant. Now if you see here, these are 4 units, that is D. And here also 4 units, it is minus 2, that is point P. And similarly for, you can find it for Q also. Q, it is 1 unit here, U, here L. So U and R are equidistant. And also R and P are equidistant from Q because they are at a distance of 2 units. So this way you can do. Now write a pair of points that we've done. Find distance UV. So UV distance is, you have to do as you have done in the previous. See here, as this is minus 4, this will become minus 5. This is 4 and then this will become 5. So how you will find the distance? So first you have to find what is the coordinate of point P, sorry, U, it is minus 5. So you have to write that minus 5 over here. And here it is 5. So which one is greater? 5 is greater. So distance what you will get? So distance of UV will be what? Greater coordinate minus smaller coordinate. So here you will get 5 minus of minus 5. So you will get 5 plus 5, which is equal to 10. So distance of UV is how much? It is 10. So this we have done in previous section. So you have to write their coordinate of U is what, coordinate of V is what, and then greater, which is greater from them, and then greater coordinate minus the smaller coordinate. So here distance UV was how much? It was 10. You can refer to our previous exercise where we have done these types of sums. Now similar way they have told you to find distance PC, distance VB and distance UL, so you can easily find that how we had done previously. Now we'll see the conditional statements and converse. The statements which can be written in the form of if and then form, they are called conditional statements. So when you write the statement in the form of if and then it is known as a conditional statement. For example, the diamonds of a rhombus are perpendicular bisectors of each other. Now, how this can be written in the if and then form? So see how they are given. If the given quadrilateral is a rhombus, then the diagonals are perpendicular bisectors of each other. So if the quadrilateral, if form. So if the quadrilateral is a rhombus, then the diagonals are perpendicular bisectors of each other. So this statement is a conditional statement. It is in the form of if and then. The statement can be written in the form of that we have done. If the antecedent and the consequent is the given condition statement are interchanged, then the resulting statement is a converse. Now see, the if form which is there, that is the antecedent, then is the consequent form. Now see, for converse, if the conditional statement it is, if a quadrilateral is a rhombus, then its diagonals are perpendicular bisector of each other. Now converse, if the diagonals of the quadrilateral are perpendicular bisectors of each other, then it is a rhombus. So you have to change the if and then form. So that will become a converse. For example, I just said now, if the quadrilateral is a rhombus, if it is a rhombus, then the diagonals are perpendicular bisector of each other. So then part we have to write in if. So that it will become, if the diagonals of the quadrilateral are perpendicular bisectors, then it is a rhombus. So if we interchange if and then position, then it will become the converse of it. So now, see the conditional statement. If a number is a prime number, then it is even or odd. So what will come in converse? If the number is even or odd, then it is a prime number. So when you are changing if and then form, it becomes a converse statement. And when the statement is in the form of if and then form, then it is known as a conditional statement. It is in the conditional statement. Now see, you see, we have studied many properties of angles, triangles and quadrilaterals through activities. So earlier standards you must have studied about the angles, different types of angles, the triangles, the quadrilaterals. So in this standard we are going to look at the subject of geometry with a different point of view. Now the Greek mathematician Euclid, who lived in the 3rd century before Christian era, he gathered the knowledge of geometry prevailing at his time. He took for granted some self-evident geometrical statements which were accepted by all and called them postulates. So these are self-evident, which doesn't need to be proved. So those are known as postulates. Now, properties proved logically. We have to prove those properties logically. Those are known as theorems, what we do here. We have to, if a statement is given and that is a theorem, we have to prove that by different steps. So that is known as theorem. And which are self-evident, which are not needed to be proved, that are known as postulates. Now see, a property is supposed to be true if it can be proved logically. So if it is supposed to be true, we have to prove it, and that is known as a theorem. And a logical argument, now that argument which you are writing to prove that theorem, that is known as proof. So when we are writing given to prove, and when you are writing the answer for it, we write first the proof. So that is the proof what we are writing for that theorem. So here some of the Euclid's postulates are given below. There are infinite lines passing through a point. There is one and only one line passing through two points, that we all know. A circle of a given radius can be drawn, taken any point as its center. All right angles are congruent to each other. So these are all postulates which are self-evident. It is true what we can read, that we don't need to prove. So if two interior angles formed on one side of the transversal of two lines add up to less than two right angles, then the lines produced in the direction they intersect each other. Add up to two right angles means 180 degrees supplementary. So now we'll see. Now we'll see the practice at 1.3. What they have given there is, write the following statements in if and then form. If and then form. So you have to write it in the conditional form. So we'll see that. So for that, the first question they have given is, write the following. Now this is practice set 1.3. So first one is, the opposite angles of a parallelogram are congruent. So what will be the if and then form? So if a quadrilateral is a parallelogram, if a quadrilateral is a parallelogram, then its opposite angles are congruent. So see, the opposite angles of a parallelogram are congruent. So if and then from how you write, if the quadrilateral is a parallelogram, then its opposite angles will be congruent. Now see for the second one. The diagonals of a rectangle are congruent. Now here also you will write, if a quadrilateral is a rectangle, then its diagonals are congruent. So if a quadrilateral is a rectangle, then its diagonals are congruent. So in the second case also, the diagonals of a rectangle are congruent. So if the quadrilateral is a rectangle, then only the diagonals will be congruent. This is the if and then form. Now we'll see the third one. In an isosceles triangle, the segment joining the vertex and the midpoint of the base is perpendicular to the base. Now see, in an isosceles triangle, the segment joining the vertical and the midpoint of the base is perpendicular to the base. So it is in an isosceles triangle. So here it will come, if the triangle is an isosceles triangle, then the segment joining. Because your main condition is that it should be an isosceles triangle, then only you will get the next condition. So here you have to write, if a triangle is an isosceles triangle, then the segment, then you have to write the remaining part, then the segment joining the vertex and the midpoint of the base is perpendicular to the base. So I hope you understood how you can write the if and then forms. Now next we will see how to write the converse. Now see the first one. Here you have to write the the alternate angles formed by two parallel lines and their transversal are congruent. Now see, if the alternate angle made by the two lines and its transversal are congruent, then the two lines will be parallel. Here you have to write the converse of these statements. So here you have to write, if alternate angles made by two lines and its transversal are congruent, then the lines are so here see, if the alternate angles made by the two lines and its transversal are congruent, then the two lines will be parallel. So this is the converse for this statement. Similarly, you will have, if a pair of the interior angles made by a transversal of two lines are supplementary, then the lines are parallel. So if two parallel lines are intersected by a transversal, then the interior angles which are formed, which will be supplementary. The third one, the diagonals of a rectangle are congruent. Now, if the diagonals of a rectangle are congruent, then the quadrilateral is a rectangle. Now, here, this is the third one. So, in this way, you can write the converses of the following statements. Now, further we will see. Now see, some similar types are there in your problem set also. Now write the following statements in conditional form, that every rhombus is a square. Now it, for that conditional statements, what you will write for every rhombus is a square, like previously we had done in the square, in the first part of this exercise. If a quadrilateral is a rhombus, then it is a square. So here it is, every rhombus is a square. Rhombus is a square. When it is a rhombus. So if every quadrilateral is a rhombus, then only it is a square. Second, angles in a linear pair are supplementary. Now, for it to be supplementary, it should be in a linear pair. So if the angles are in a linear pair, they are supplementary. Now, triangle is a figure formed by three segments. Now, if a figure is a triangle, if it is a triangle, then it is formed by three segments. A number having only two divisors is a prime number. Now, if a number is having only two divisors, then it is a prime number. So, these are the if and the then conditional forms. Now, see the converses. If the sum of the measure of angle in a figure is 180, then the figure is a triangle. So, if the figure is a triangle, then the sum will be 180. So in this way, you can see the examples are given over here, so you can try it on yourself. So this is all what we have in this chapter. So I hope you will understand how you understood how we have to find the distances and write the if and then forms. So now we'll see something about parallel lines. I hope you will try sums from the problem sets, so that you will be able to understand more what we did in the practice sets. Now, if you see over here, the parallel lines, which is the second chapter, so here, as we all know, these are the two parallel lines and this is the transversal. See, in 8th standard also we had this. Whenever there are two parallel lines, for example, here there is M, N and this is the transversal, T. So, how many angles it is forming? It is forming 8 angles. 1, 2, 3, 4. Here 4 and downside 4. So, let me name it. For example, it is A, B, C, D, E, F, G and H. So here if you find, there are 8 angles formed, but out of this, what angles are there? Here you will find there are corresponding angles, alternate angles. We will find interior angles. Now more what you will find, there are angles in a linear pair also. Angles in a linear pair, and you will have vertically opposite angles also here. Corresponding angles are like a staircase. So when you step over here, next you will step over here. So A and E are corresponding angles, D and H are corresponding angles. If you see from above, this and this is the staircase. So B and F will be corresponding angles, C and G will be corresponding angles. And accordingly, if you see for Z, now Z is, this is the Z which is formed. So here are the corners of the Z, these are alternate angles. So B, H alternate angle, C and E will be alternate angles. These are integral alternate angles. And exterior alternate angles here will be A and here it will be G. So these, always remember, alternate angles, they form corners of a Z. So it is easy for you to make out the alternate angles. Then we have interior angles. Now interior angles which lie inside. So this B and E, they are interior angles. They lie in between the two parallel lines and the transversal. And it is on the one side and between the lines. So these are the interior angles. Now we have angles in a linear pair. They are the adjacent angles. These angles are angles in a linear pair. So many pairs we are having. CD, BA, AH, CB. These are angles in a linear pair. Now we have vertically opposite angles. Now vertically opposite angles are these, A and C, which are vertically opposite to each other. AC, DB, EG, HF. So these are vertically opposite angles. Now further, now property C, corresponding angles, they are congruent to each other. So if there are corresponding angles formed by two parallel lines and one transversal, so all corresponding angles will be congruent to, the pairs will be congruent to each other. Then alternate angles are also congruent to each other. Then we have interior angles. Now interior angles are not congruent to each other. Interior angles, their sum is supplementary, means their sum is 180. Angles in a linear pair also, linear pair, they form supplementary angles, means they form 180. The sum is 180 in linear pair also. Vertically opposite angles are congruent to each other. So in this way you will find that these are the angles which are formed by two parallel lines and one transversal. So you can remember these with the help of which we will solve sums. So this is all for this session. We'll continue in the next session. Thank you.